That's going light.
Good evening, folks. You're tuned in to Radio SAF here in Kinloch, and we're going to be speaking to Eddie Mitchell this evening, independent candidate for Leitrim. How are you, Eddie?
Very well.
It's nice to have you in the studio.
Yeah, it's lovely to get an opportunity to talk.
Yeah, well, this is the station for the people, folks, and Eddie's going to speak on his own behalf and his canvas and how he's running out there at the moment and what he's actually, what's his points for running in the local election for the council. We're going out now with a bit of music, and it's Nancy Mon and it's Bertha O'Donnell from Connemara. Hope you're all going to enjoy the show here at Radio SAF, the voice in your own community. Folks, tune in. Hello to everybody as well on TikTok and all platforms.
Last night I had a pleasant dream. I woke up with a smile. I dreamt that I was back again in dear old Devonshire. I thought I saw Loch Allen's banks in the valleys down below. It was my lovely Leitrim where the shanty waters flow. I stood enchanted by the scene of grandeur and light. I headed off for Kerry town before the dark of night. I passed Sheemore, that fairy hill where flowers widely grow, and I saw the grave of Finn McCool where the shadow waters flow. The next I saw was Fane town with her ancient and wall, where the preaching of her holy monks re-echoes through her hall. I stood with reverence on the spot, reluctant for to go. From the town of saints and sages where the shining waters flow, I have traveled far through these great lands, from the east on to the west. But of all the islands I have seen, I love my own the best. And if ever I return again, there's one place I will go. It will be to lovely Leitrim where the shadow waters flow.
Well, Larry Cunningham there, and indeed to lovely Leitrim, and what a great song and a great singer Larry was, a legend indeed, for the Leitrim people and all around the world. Fáilte seach chuirte go tí radio slíomh a lantaíon in seo a mondóran a bhondé don an áil a sún an bhúm náin seach tenna más an bláir an ocht. A géisio chlé, Eddie Mitchell, as Menor Hamilton, a tá a grich a bhúlitiocht lehi an lehin téirma in iste te sos in mi smí seo hagain. A sún an bhúm náin seach tenna más a bláir. Hope he's all going to enjoy the show. It's Eddie Mitchell with me here in the studio, independent candidate for Leitrim. Well, Eddie, what made you come this distance actually to stand for a candidate for Leitrim as an independent candidate? And I'd like to ask you to introduce yourself to the people.
Well, I'm Eddie Mitchell. I'm a farmer in North Leitrim, a sheep farmer. I'm married to Olivia. We have four nearly adult children at this stage. I'm 51 now, but I've been fighting environmental campaigns for the last 13 years.
That's right. And I believe you were involved in the fracking as well, Eddie.
I was. I suppose what I want to do is, I want to get into the council because I see some serious issues that are fundamental to Leitrim that we can't really solve without a mandate from the people. And we've been operating with existing councillors for years, and they've always served us very well. But there's two spaces now in the council. Frank Doran and Sean McDermott are stepping back. So there's an opportunity for the environmental people to step in and start to deal with some of these issues that we have.
You know, there's serious issues in like with farming and everything, Eddie, I believe. Yeah. So, you know, indeed, the fracking must have needed anyway. Thank God that was cancelled down and got rid of, because in my opinion, that would ruin the farming industry around those counties coming through their lands and everything, you know.
Yeah, and what happened with fracking was that, you know, 22 groups, hundreds of people campaigned for 6 years.
Yes.
But, and we won the argument. But winning the argument wasn't the only thing that happened. What happened was that the government couldn't implement their plans because the people who control the land didn't allow it. So it was the joining up of farmers and environmentalists that actually stopped fracking.
Yeah, well, good job on their behalf and our ye bit, on all your behalf, because that's amazing to see. You know, what would you like to speak about, Eddie, yourself now? Like, I know that we have notes here, because as you rang me this evening, and it's nice to have you here, I didn't get much time to read into all your information on your leaflet. And I'd like to ask, you know, what type of activism do you have been involved in recent years as well?
Yeah, well, I've been involved in lots of stuff from working on the fracking issue to forestry to mining in Leitrim, and now hopefully if we get into the council, I'm going to try and deal with planning. But what I want to talk about this evening is extractivism. Like, so Leitrim is a unique place in that land is cheap, the population is low. We have a lot of natural resources. So we have gas, we have maybe gold and copper and silver, and we have all these metals that everybody's looking for. And we have land available for forestry. So there's two possible futures for Leitrim.
Yes.
One future is an extractive economy where we allow the external interests, the market, to come in here and exploit the resources that are here.
Yes.
And the other possible future is the future where we lived in when we banned fracking, where the people are strong, where the community is resilient, and where we hold on to control over the county, and we reject polluting industries.
Yes, pollution.
And it's a great opportunity to try and bring all of these issues together, because we need to operate in Leitrim in the reality that if we don't find solutions that solve the problems of extractivism, we don't have a future. So, like, people talk about planning and they talk about septic tanks, and we know that it's very difficult to get planning permission in Leitrim.
Absolutely.
But the reason that you can't get planning permission in Leitrim isn't really because of septic tanks. So there's a couple of bits of criteria you have to meet. You have to be local. If you want to get rural planning, you have to be local. The roads, has to be safe access onto the roads. And you have to be able to have a septic tank that passes the T-test. So those things can be... So safe access... there should be plenty of locations where you can access the roads.
Yes.
And if there's work to be done further down the road to make something safe, the council should be prepared to facilitate works like that. The septic tanks should be straightforward, because there is technical solutions. And if people... So we should be trying to find solutions. And the solutions are there. There's nobody arguing that the solutions aren't there. And being local... I'm not sure that being local is enough in Leitrim. I think we should be trying to bring people to Leitrim.
Yes, bring people in, yeah. So and bring people back as well, that's gone for a while, you know, immigrated. Yeah. There should be some kind of an interest for the people to come back. Housing would be one, because there is an issue with housing.
Yeah.
Council housing as well as, you know, there's nothing available at holiday, like, you know, for people that want to move back.
Yes, all of these things are issues, but what's at the back of all of these things? So if you have a government that wants to plant 8,000, between 8,000 and 30,000 hectares, yes, of forestry every year, mm-hmm, and you have the European Union that wants to go from 3% mineral extraction to 10% within between now and 2030,
mm-hmm,
if that's the situation and you're and Leitrim is the focus of that,
mm-hmm,
you can understand why the government doesn't want people living there, because every family that lives in Leitrim, every new house that's built,
yeah,
is a family that's rooted to the area that will stand and fight against extractivism.
Yes.
So we can't solve our problems in Leitrim unless we deal with extractivism. So when we banned fracking in 2017, we realised we have power. We stood up to the oil and gas industry.
Hmm.
But we always also understood that while the gas is in the ground, that any win is temporary. Like, can you imagine if in the next couple of weeks the situation that's happened in Israel took a turn for the worse and the Suez Canal was blocked for a month?
That would be cause huge,
yeah,
complications.
What had happened is that you know, oil and gas that's coming out of that region couldn't be guaranteed for Europe.
Not at all.
Or for lots of parts of the world.
That's why we need to find our own.
And that's what the government would say. The government,
yeah,
would say we need our own oil and gas.
Yeah.
And that's why this is such a concern. And it wouldn't be about the Irish government saying they want their own. It'd be about the UK government and the 65 million people that live over there, along with the Irish people, saying we need to look back at our own resources,
yes,
and develop our own gas. Now, if we do that, that puts the people in Leitrim back into the firing line. So while we have a ban on fracking, and it's very important, and it's important for the listeners to understand that Northern Ireland just agreed to a ban on petroleum licensing as well. Finally, we have the DUP and Sinn Féin both agreeing that there should be a ban on petroleum licensing. And that's going to be brought into the executive fairly soon. And then they've agreed that before 2025, there'll be a ban on fracking in the north, similar to that in the south. But
that's great news, though.
It is.
Farmers and, you know, the whole area.
Yeah, but
plus we're still in the green area, the clean, you know, without more pollution and stuff. Like, you know, can you imagine if all of that happened and the uproars and problems we would have,
yeah,
in the community?
But so I'm also canvassing in areas, and I see that, you know, at the moment, the sort of idea is that, well, maybe if people can't get planning permission in the countryside, Leitrim people, that they could move into the towns and villages and,
yes,
and buy houses that are for sale there. But just to give you an example of that situation, in Drumahaire before COVID, there were houses that were for sale for 80,000.
That's right.
Those houses are almost 300,000 now.
Yes, they are, because values now.
Because people are now coming to live in Leitrim and they have to work from home and they have good jobs and they can afford to pay for them. And they're selling property in Dublin and things like that. So at the moment, if you were a young person in Leitrim, the chances of you being able to afford to buy a house at 300,000 are limited.
Oh, very limited, yeah.
So what happens if people can't live in the areas where they grow up, they end up being displaced.
Yeah.
The history of Leitrim is about displacing people. We call it emigration. It's displacement. If consider what's happening in Palestine, we know that there's ethnic cleansing going on there now.
Mm-hmm.
People are being removed from Gaza. We know there's a genocide going on. But it's illegal to remove an ethnic group,
mm-hmm,
from their land.
Yes, of course, from their origins.
But it's only illegal if it's done quickly.
Yeah.
It's actually not illegal to do it slowly. So removing people from the land in Leitrim. So I'll give you an example of what that, in reality, what that means. So 30 years ago, there was twice as much land in Leitrim been used to grow grass as there is now, because half of the land that was available to grow grass has moved into forestry. Now, how did that happen without us noticing? It happened that every 3 years, 1% of Leitrim went into forestry.
Right.
And forestry is a permanent land use change. When land goes into forestry, it can never come back.
Not so.
So, you know, this slow... So imagine in 30 years, we've lost half our land that was available for agriculture. And now, imagine now that we've got a government that wants to plant between 8 and 30,000 hectares a year. And the only place that they can plant that land is in places where, like Leitrim. So yes. There's about 6 counties in Ireland that the forestry industry operate in.
Right.
So I'm involved in Save Leitrim, and Save Leitrim have been slowing down forestry. We recognised this about 6 or 7 years ago. And we've been opposing these. What happens with forestry is you have to get a permit. Mm-hmm. Okay. So people can make submissions and object to land going into forestry to the permitting system. But usually what happens is they just change it and send it back out. So you don't really win those. They get sent back to the developer to resubmit.
Yes.
So it's a constant battle trying to slow down companies that want to plant Sika spruce. But we have been successful in Leitrim because we've been engaging in that, and they've felt it easier to go other places. But so the amount of forestry that was being planted there for a couple of years was very low, and the government had to come up with a solution to that. So the solution that they came up with was that Quilche made a deal with asset manager called Gresham House. So Gresham House own 80% of the trees in Scotland.
Right.
So they're a huge corporate hedge fund type, you know,
company, yeah.
Massive company. So they'll be able to draw down premiums. Quilche couldn't draw down premiums because they weren't farmers, but these private companies can draw down premiums.
Yeah.
So Gresham House will be able to draw down public money to buy land and plant it in Leitrim, and Quilche will facilitate them and do the work.
One will back the other.
So what we have is we have the state facilitating corporates to displace people from rural Leitrim. So our solutions in Leitrim, where we try to object and do stuff, they're not going to work anymore because, first of all, we were never getting projects stopped. We were only getting them sent back out to get turned around and reapply for permits. So it's important to understand that this means that from now on land is going to move out of local ownership into corporate ownership. So if you imagine Scotland, like, where are all the people in Scotland? I think there's only 4 million people in Scotland.
Yeah, that's about it.
Most of them are in cities.
Yeah.
Scotland is empty. And if you go to Scotland and you look at a big mountain covered in heather, the chances are it's owned by a billionaire, it's not owned by people.
Yeah.
And most of the forestry is owned by, like 80% of the trees in Scotland are owned by Gresham House already. So they're looking at a place like the, you know, these poorer counties in the west of Ireland.
Yeah, because the land's taken away from the people.
Well, so you imagine that, like, there's always a certain amount of land that's moving, that's going up for sale.
Yes.
Because somebody dies, somebody gets sick, or kids are going to college. There's always a need for to sell land or to sell the property. So what can happen is that what our future could look like is that as that land comes up for sale, like we have land coming up for sale there in Hamilton, where it goes up for sale one day, the local farmers go in and they say, "Can I have an interest in buying that land?" But the land is already sale agreed. So whereas if farming in Leitrim, you could afford to pay 4,000 or 5,000 an acre for land,
mm-hmm.
they can pay 8,000 or 9,000 an acre. So that means that, think about how we stopped fracking.
Yeah.
The people who didn't want, who the environmentalists and the farmers worked together.
Yes.
But if we're seeing land go out of local ownership, it means that there's nobody to stand on the road.
To protect it.
To protect it.
Yeah, that's where the problems are.
So we lose our connection with the plant. So the context there is that if we move away from a normal vibrant rural economy to an extractive economy,
mm-hmm.
That can only happen against the wishes of the people.
Yes.
So then there's tools that they use for that. Did you want to say something?
That's all. Yeah. You can say.
So one of the reasons that I got involved in the anti-fracking campaign was when I understood the nature of what was coming, I read all the legislation. And when you looked at the Petroleum Act, what happened was that the government was going to give the company a lease over an area like the size of North Leitrim. And under that lease, the company had a right to access all land for the purposes of extract, so for anything that they deemed. So if they wanted to turn a lorry in a field, they could do that because it was for the purposes of extracting petroleum. So the farmers ended up having to share land with the oil and gas industry.
Which should be ridiculous. Like.
Yes, but that's what the law said. So the law, do you know the way the ESB can go into your land and put up a pole? And the ESB will always ask permission, and they'll always say, look, I'd like to put a pole in that field. And the farmer can say, will you put it in this corner? And they'll always be helpful.
Yes.
But so you end up in a situation where the company wants to put in a 12 hectare pad.
Yes.
And you can say, I'd like to put it over there, but they're looking at hundreds of millions of gas under the ground. You're not a priority.
You're not a priority.
You can negotiate, but you have no right to negotiate. You have no right to say no.
Yes, because that's what they were all trying to do. And yes. It was great, actually, to see that they were stopped.
Yeah,
you know?
So we know that they were stopped, but we know the gas is still there. And we know that the climate reasons for not taking out that gas
mm-hmm.
are now under threat from security reasons. So
yes.
as the world is changing and security is starting to become more important than climate action, there's a risk there. Now, I don't want to dwell too much on the risk, but the reason that it's important is because I'm trying to for people to understand how important local planning is. It's fundamental. Now we also have mining being proposed in Leitrim, and so we have gold mining being proposed in 47 town lands, and the legislation that surrounds that means that in the past, if somebody wanted to do prospecting, they needed to ask the farmer's permission.
Yes.
But that legislation has now been changed, so that if a farmer refuses access to a mining company, the mining company can now apply to the High Court and force access onto that land.
Yes.
So what it's telling you is that if we move to an extractive economy, it will have to be imposed.
Yes, imposed, yeah.
And the tools are in place to impose that. You're talking about projects that are acting in the overriding public interest, as in the global interest, the European interest, against local interests. So an area being turned into a sacrifice zone for a wider interest,
yes.
like a security interest or whatever, or for growth or whatever in Europe.
Yeah, well, and you were successful in that, and that's great to see it anyway. Like, you know, that's one thing that didn't happen.
Yeah, well, the gold hasn't been stopped now. So fracking has been stopped. We got legislation to stop that. But what happened with the gold mining was that in the last year or two, we got Leitrim County Council to put a ban on the use of cyanide in the processing of ore.
Right.
So what they're saying is that there's an unacceptable risk associated with the processing of ore with cyanide, because it's going to. There's an unacceptable risk that water will be damaged in Leitrim, and that water feeds into Sligo.
And polluted.
And gets polluted. That's the drinking water for Sligo and Leitrim.
That's one thing that has to be kept clear at all times
because
of human consumption and everything.
So every time we make an attempt to solve the problem, so we were able to solve the problem on fracking, but we know that that could be undone. It's only a matter of making a decision.
Yes.
And if you've got a government that has a majority in the Dáil, they could take away the fracking ban. Now, we wouldn't expect that had happened in Ireland, but it's good to understand that it could happen.
Yeah.
Now, so let's look at mining. Okay. So mining now, 27% of Ireland mm-hmm. is under prospecting for minerals at the moment for mining, and the contrast to that is that England has only 3%. So what the wider context is that the West has been pushed out of the global South. So there, China and America are fighting over access to minerals in South America and Africa. But America's losing that battle. So America and the West are now looking at their own minerals in their own country. So they're putting public money now into finding and extracting their own resources. So that's the. So imagine, go back now and look at what Europe's plan is. So last March was the quickest legislation that ever went through Europe. And it's a regulation and now law here since last March. And that is that Europe will go from developing 3% of its own minerals to 10% by 2030.
My God, that's massive.
So that's why mining. So how they do that is they're going to allow state aid to fund mining. They're going to allow the mining companies to draw down European investment funds. They're going to guarantee planning permission for mining within 2 years, and they're going to guarantee processing applications within 1 year after that. So our little ban on cyanide in Leitrim is up against
all of this.
All of this.
That's Eddie, that's great. We'll go to a bit of music now.
Okay. Sorry.
And we'll give you a wee bit of a break.
Yeah.
And then we'll come back to the next part of the show. You're tuned in to Radio SAF. We are with Eddie Mitchell, independent candidate for Leitrim folks, on the show this evening. And we're going to be chatting to Eddie again after the bit of music that's coming up for you. John, you have it all in order there now.
We'll go with Sabrina Fallon here, like Old Maid in Garden.
Oh, the Old Maid in the Garden, yeah. Sabrina Fallon from Galway, McDermott.
Call me his own beauty and the soul of the enemy. I'll surely get a parrot and the gold dear and me.
Leitrim here, folks, and Eddie will be talking to us shortly. Before that, we'll put out a bit more music. This is the People's Station. This is belonging to the community. Come on in, folks, and speak to us about any matter ye have to speak about. The station's open to anybody. Suggestions, questions and answers, music, etc. As I did say, before I go any further, we're in the Chasing Bull later as well. 10 p.m. tonight, kicking off with the Chasing Bull in Bundoran. Say hello to everybody there in the Chasing Bull. Hello to everybody who's tuned into the show as well on TikTok, on our Facebook pages, also on Radio Shlian Alanthi Ian, Faltishtech, and also on Instagram. Hopefully, you're all enjoying the show. Well, John, you put out another song before we go speaking to Eddie?
Lisa McHugh, Applejack.
Oh, Applejack, and it's Lisa McHugh, the girl from Scotland.
There's a song for me, Applejack. Applejack, there's a song for me, and I'll sing. There's a song for me, Applejack. Applejack, there's a song, let your banjo ring.
You look at the apple orchard in this little old orchard shack. His name is Jackson Taylor, but I called him Applejack.
Now old Applejack was alive by everyone. Applejack picked apples, but he picked the banjo too. Lay a song for me, Applejack. Applejack, lay a song for me, and I'll sing. Lay a song for me, Applejack. Applejack, lay a song, let your banjo ring.
I'm going down to Applejack's just almost every day. And we'd sit and we'd drink Applejack, that old Applejack had made.
Then he'd take his banjo down and he'd ask me if I'd sing. And he would play the banjo and I'd play my tambourine. Lay a song for me, Applejack, Applejack. Jack is gone.
Oh,
but he left me his banjo, and it always takes me back. And every time I play it, I still hear Applejack. Lay a song for me, Applejack. Applejack, play a song for me, and I'll sing.
Applejack. You're tuned into Radio Soft, the voice in your own community, the People's Station here in Leitrim and Donegal. Keep tuned in now as we speak to Eddie Mitchell, the independent candidate for Leitrim, and Eddie wants ye to vote him, number one, and he's telling you all why the reasons why that. And coming from a farming background, as he explained, it's a good reason to be folks to be looking for your roots to save the environment. Now, Eddie, we'll just continue on.
Yeah, so what we're talking about is the struggle between a vibrant rural economy,
yes,
that serves the people of Leitrim against an alternative extractive economy.
Yes.
And we're talking about the tools that are going to decide which way we end up. So so forestry is there's three things that play a huge part in that. So forestry, rural planning, and then farming schemes. Okay, so I'm just going to explain a little bit about forestry the way I see it. So forestry, initial afforestation is exempt from planning. So that's important because it means that as a county, we have no say over our forestry. So in other words, if forestry was subject to planning permission, like the way we say wind turbines are subject to planning permission.
That's right.
So because wind turbines are subject to planning permission, there's a map in the county development plan that says that there's a map of Leitrim and different areas are indicated, some where there's high capacity, low capacity, or no capacity. And if you apply for planning permission in an area where the Leitrim local authority has said there's no capacity, it should be difficult to get permission for something like a wind turbine in a place like that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So that's the way that planning operates. So because forestry is exempt from planning, it means that Leitrim County Council can't draw a map of Leitrim and say there is no capacity in this area because there's already too much thick spruce here, the schools are closing, or there's
business closing.
Mm-hmm. Or because we want to encourage people to live in a place.
Yes, okay? Exactly.
So you can see that. Now imagine if you were trying to plan Leitrim. Can you imagine if you would imagine Leitrim people signing off on a plan that would allow the land that's controlled by the people to go into corporate ownership? It just wouldn't happen. There's no way that people would agree to a plan that displaced.
It's completely corporate and not private or personal. Well,
corporate means that we have no people. You know, yes. It's just something that will be bought and sold on the global market.
Yes, exactly.
And an awful lot of our forestry is corporate owned. Sometimes people plant land, and then after a few years, it ends up being sold to corporates. They'll come and offer money for it after it's established. But it always ends up, mostly ends up in corporate ownership. We have done a little bit of looking at who owns the land in Leitrim,
yes,
and we're finding that the land that's planted ends up in corporate ownership. But now we see this plan where Quilcha and Gresham House are going to partner and be able to pay far more than anybody else for land. So as land comes up for sale, we're going to see corporate ownership from now on. So if you're a government and you want to have an extractive zone,
mm-hmm,
you'll use forestry to displace people.
Yes, you will, of course. Because to get rid of them out of the area, Eddie.
Because, the corporates aren't interested in stopping fracking or protecting the environment. They're interested in making money.
Yeah.
And it opens it up. So that's one thing. So forestry, in order to solve the problem with forestry, all we have to do is, and this is a simple thing to happen in the Dáil, a little piece of legislation needs to be removed, repeated, mm-hmm, is that initial afforestation is no longer exempt from planning.
Yes, exactly. It shouldn't be exempt from planning.
And it shouldn't be exempt.
Because if you're looking for planning permission for a house and you're in a scenic view, you won't get planning because you're blocking the scenic view. What about the forestry, blocking the people that has houses on the other direction, on the other side of the river road? It's the same thing. There's no difference.
It makes absolutely no sense that forestry should be exempt from planning.
It shouldn't be.
And the reason that it's exempt is because it's going to displace people,
mm-hmm,
and allow land to go into
to forestry, not to the people,
permanently.
Yeah.
And in the case of Leitrim, It means that it's going to displace people that would fight to protect the environment.
Exactly.
Now, so planning is another tool that's used. Because if you won't allow young people to live in their own areas,
mm-hmm.
as we said, then they're not going to be there to vote, first of all.
Yes, or to have a voice.
Like in the area that I'm in now, in I suppose I'm replacing Sean McDermott as a councillor, and his area and where I live, so Denboy, Glenfarn, Kilty Clocher, Ballymehan, Glenanniff, and up into back into Tootfield and Manor Hamilton, and including Manor Hamilton. So that's a massive area. But because of forestry and because people can't get planning permission,
mm-hmm.
the numbers are dropping significantly in those areas. So it'll be difficult for us to get the 800 or 900 votes to elect a councillor. So you're going to see a massive part of North Leitrim, possibly without any political representation at all. And
yes.
And that's because of displacement of people.
Yeah, and also, you know, like a councillor in these areas is badly needed because it's the voice of the people
yeah.
as well. And whatever hope that community area has,
yeah.
with their own representative.
Yeah.
To build on things that they need and actually to make it bigger and better for them and actually to bring something good into the area that the people can live there.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Employment would be another part of it. Housing is another part of it. And it's not even that, the youth, Teddy.
Yeah.
You know, the youth, I see a lot of problems with the youth. Like, the youth is forgotten about, and so is the elderly.
Yeah.
And I keep fighting for double time because I think that they should be, you know, say the youth, like, they have nowhere to go and talk.
Yeah.
And some
yeah.
people, they don't want to speak to their parents. I would love to see youth hubs all over this area,
yeah.
from Donegal down into North Leitrim and
yeah.
south, north, east and west, because I think that's needed. Because if the youth have the activity as well, they
yeah.
meet up and they meet people,
yeah.
and that's how it starts to kind of populate again.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, people coming in from different counties
yeah.
On Friday night, meeting each other
yeah.
and having different events and activities. I mean, that adds an interest to the community. The elderly as well. The elderly has nothing to go to.
Yes.
There's nothing there for them. Like
yeah.
senior citizens should have events two or three times a month, even every Friday a month, to bring them out into society after
yeah.
the COVID.
Yes.
And I have spoken about this situation, like, but I think we have to first start looking after the environment,
yeah, yeah.
looking after our youth.
Yeah.
And
well,
we need to get
those young people involved in the struggles.
Exactly.
Because these struggles are about their future. So they we need to get young people to understand.
Yes.
Why, like, I have young people saying to me things like, I'll never be able to live in a house. I'll never be able to build a house or afford a house. Like, it's always been difficult for every generation to get foothold, and the easiest thing is to leave.
Yeah, but sure, if their land is sold to forestries and,
yeah.
and everything else, they could buy a plot of land for 30, 40 grand. That's a great start.
Yeah.
But when the land is gone, and it's actually bought by a government agency,
yeah. Yeah.
and they're using it for their own pockets, and they're not thinking about the public, they're not thinking about the society
I think that there is such a thing as a sacrifice zone, and I think people can be displaced in because of there's an alternative interest. And I think that Europe wants Leitrim to be a sacrifice zone. I think that the government wants Leitrim to be a sacrifice zone. So the young people in Leitrim are in a struggle between two alternative futures.
Oh, there you.
But so autonomy is something that's really important. Like, so one of the other things that, where if you think about the things that could go, so we know that the issues with forestry and planning
mm-hmm.
are there to displace people.
Mm-hmm.
So what are the things then that could help people? So when you look at farming and you look at the acre scheme,
mm-hmm.
okay? So we're now talking about getting money for these public goods. So we want money for climate action and biodiversity and stuff like that. And those things could be very positive and they could help to compete against forestry. But there's very little autonomy in those things.
Yeah.
So what happens there is you get people, And they need, like I know from my own case, if the acres payment doesn't come, there's no food, there's no payment for the mortgage. We're in trouble straight away.
Exactly. That's why Tagus years ago was involved as well. And they were paying something like 10 grand so much a hectare to people, like, you know.
Yeah.
And that did help the farmers a lot.
And
it is helpful.
But you have to understand, it's not a solution.
Oh, God, it's not. No.
Because the problem with that solution is that if the government want to make Leitrim into a sacrifice zone, they have the ability to turn that down, to make it more difficult to get, mm-hmm. to control it. So what we need to do in Leitrim is we need to develop, we need to create autonomy. So we need to create a brand that's Leitrim.
Yeah.
So we need to get them paid for what we produce. So let's say we're producing lamb, or we're producing weanlings, or we need to be able to say that they're like the environmental route is a good way to go in terms of being able to say that this is sustainable produce.
Exactly.
And be able to sell something at a good price.
Or so, dairy as well, milk,
yeah,
cheese, butter.
We have very little milk now in North Leitrim.
We don't, that's a problem.
But what we need to do is we need to develop an economy where the people have control over what they're producing. So that we can compete against a government turning down the payments. So when we become dependent on the government for payments, we're caught. Like what I see is people coming out with solutions to the forestry problem. And the solution is, well, let's get more money. You know, let's get another scheme. But what we need actually is we need to start to brand Leitrim and sell it and start to allow to create a sustainable economy.
Mm.
Like for another good possibility there is people being able to work from home on the internet.
Yes.
So what happens in that situation is that the land is where we get our identity from. It's our foundation.
Yeah.
And the income from land can end up being a good foundation for our incomes, but we can have some control over our incomes if we can have online work, and that's a game changer for Leitrim. If we can get people to move into Leitrim that can work on the internet and live here and have deep roots here and want to protect the place or hold our young people here and get them jobs where they can remain in the countryside. So these are things that are possible, but there's fundamental things. So these are things that other councillors aren't talking about. That's why I'm speaking about them today.
Exactly.
There's loads of stuff that we have to do, and everybody knows that. But this is the stuff, I think, that has to be at the heart of whatever happens in the council, because this is about the future of Leitrim. Now, in order for us to the first thing that we managed to do was to ban fracking.
Mm-hmm.
So we missed that bullet. So we need to hold our population. And we need to build the resiliency here so that we can be able to defend that for the next round.
Exactly.
We need to ban gold mining. Now we tried to put something in the county development plan. It's strong, very strong. The Leitrim County Council recognised that they oppose gold mining, but that needs to become legislation in the door. So we need to create legislation that will ban gold mining.
Yes. Because that's vital important.
Yeah.
Because from that, you know, you have a lot of pollution if that happens.
Well, that's just,
you know.
What gold mining would do is it would introduce an extractive industry into North Leitrim. Now, imagine if we had farmers that were struggling competing with miners on good wages. What would happen is the company, as that's what's happened in Tara Mines, would say, oh, we have to let you all go.
Yeah, exactly.
But lads, if you compete, if you lobby to get the fracking going, then you have loads of jobs, you know? So what happens is that the extractive economy becomes the dominant economy.
And of course, it's not your locals either that would be involved in these projects and these jobs, you know, Eddie. There would be people from outside, you know. That's another problem.
Well, it could be some locals. And that creates division, which further weakens the local economy. Mm-hmm. But so the threat, we have to keep extractive industries out of Leitrim if we want to protect it from extractive future. So we have to ban gold mining, because gold mining isn't one of the listed minerals in the Critical Raw Materials Act that's going to facilitate mining, but it's where the companies make their money.
Yeah.
So we have to take that out, and then that leaves Leitrim a lot less viable, or iron a lot less viable for that industry. So we have to ban gold mining, and then we have to deal with the planning issue. If we can't, so we have to put a team of people together, face this silent policy, and get support at the highest levels, to get people to create the conditions where people can live here.
Exactly. You
know? So if I get into the council, I'll have a mandate, then to proceed with those things.
Yeah, to find your solutions for the problems, really.
And I know that if we do that, we will get the support of North Leitrim councillors, and then that means then that we should get the support of the whole county. Now, we've been operating like that from outside the council, with the support of the councillors, but we really need to get into the council. Like, so we were lucky when we dealt with fracking, but now, so mining, just to go back to the mining, so the mining is going to be dead. So they learned from their mistakes when they tried to introduce an oil and gas industry into Europe. It was rejected nearly everywhere in Europe because of what was happening to communities in America. But what they decided then with mining is that they'd operate at the multi-state level. So one official from Ireland will sit on a European mining board to make the decisions for mining in Europe.
My God, that's not good enough, luck either. Yeah. Isn't
it depressing? But like, the context of this is, look what's happening in Palestine. Look what's happening in the world. The world is in a mess. And all of that stuff comes to our door. It doesn't, you're not just looking at it on the television. It's real, and it affects
the world. Of course, yeah. It's crazy, like, as well. And, you know, it's causing harm.
Yeah.
So to the youth as well, it's causing harm. COVID did, everything. All these things that came aboard, I find that at the minute, the next generation coming up is very important to our generation.
Yeah.
It's what we show them and teach them, that they're going to actually express themselves.
Yeah.
And going to fight for.
Yeah.
But if they're not there if they're extracted, then they're at a loss. And that's what I keep saying to people, you know, like, get them involved.
Yeah. Like, the first thing that happens in an extractive economy is that the people get extracted. You know? Now, I have 4 children, and I hope that they'll end up in Leitrim.
But I hope so.
Now, we always left, you know, and then we came back.
Yeah.
But we just can't afford to lose. The young people.
Not at all.
And we have to fight. So it's going to take more than me ending up in the council.
Well, of course, it's going to take a good few people to do it.
Yes,
you know?
It's going to take a good few people.
Well, Eddie, will we have a bit more music before we continue on with the next part of it? Folks, you tuned into Radio SAF, and we're with Eddie Mitchell, independent candidate for Leitrim this evening. Hope he's all enjoying the show and listening to Eddie's great conversation here on the environment and why he's running for politics in the local election in June, the 7th of June. And I hope that we're all learning a bit from what Eddie has to say to us and tell us about what's really happening in County Leitrim. And thank you all for tuning in on all platforms this evening. You tuned in to your local community station, Radio SAF.
I think the way this thing switched itself off, unfortunately, it's misbehaving like the last time. It's misbehaving.
Thank you, Margaret Rich. Grumil Mahat. Tasha Begeshta Kachorti, the Radio Shlina Lampian and Shaw. How much you never gone daily to my Cantley, Eddie Mitchell, a Thai Greek, a bullet yacht, a Hansley John, Emmanuel Hamilton, the son of Gulch Brig, Montana Mars Glor, it was a Geisha Green, Licker Thai Geddy Lerolip, and a Glor in Yove. You tuned in to Radio SAF. We're going to a bit of music now. As I did say, this is the People's Station, the voice in your own community, broadcasting worldwide here on the World Wide Web as well. Find us on all our platforms, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, and our website. Also live on YouTube and Twitch TV. As I did say, we're going from here this evening as well, and we will be live from the Chase and Bull and Bundoran later from 10 p.m. tonight. Kicks off the music at the Chase and Bull. But we are at the minute speaking to a local councillor to be elected, hopefully in the community, because I see a lot of good points in what Eddie Mitchell has to say about County Leitrim, and I think he deserves to be elected as a candidate, because it's very clear to see what's happening in our community. And without the voices of the candidates and the politicians in our community, it's like media. You don't have much. So keep tuned in. Right, John, away with the music.
We're going to fire it in with John Burke, led to Mullenberg.
So you all get familiar who Eddie Mitchell is, and he's looking for your number one. We are just going to put up his brochure here for you while we play the music.
I've left behind Letter Mullen by the sea. Those one time poets so often wrote of a beauty spots and scenes, of Killarney's lakes and the old black stairs and the wild cliffs of Raheem. While I do reign, I still maintain how wrong they proved to be. Had they only roamed your sunny shores, Letter Mullen by the sea. It's like the best in the far away west, where the tourists come with you. When they're on the glen with fearless men who make the mountain dew, the golden lace that surrounds your base is a major task for thee. As it grows the seeds in your cozy fields, Letter Mullen by the sea. Mountain dew is an ancient brew, it dates back through centuries. And how it's made at full-scale trade is a miracle to me. If you're at the still at their free will, you could have the souls of unfree and enjoy it. Toast to what the natives boast, and Letter Mullen by the sea. To growing folk who have their youth, and they do not feel confined. Still the day draws near, and soon you'll hear that they've left their homes behind. Not one of those that ever flows from the shores of Inishfree shouldn't think so fond of their friends beyond Letter Mullen by the sea. when I left home and climbed to Rome, it never failed my mind. That in John Bull's land compelled to stand, I'd become the foreign line. My cards I drew to come home to you and to have a drink with thee. Where breezes blow and the waters flow and let her mullet by the sea.
Hope you're all enjoying the show, and you're tuned in to the Weeks in Politics here at Radio SAF, where we're speaking to Eddie Mitchell, independent candidate for Leitrim, and Eddie has a lot of interesting matters to talk to on about tease on the show, and I hope you're all enjoying the show this evening, and it's the Weeks in Politics here at Radio SAF. Now, folks, a bit more music coming up shortly. Tasha Big Aishat, the Radio Schley in Atlantic Yen, in Shaw, Igan Locha in Yuv, Gohondun and Mondoran, Achtamadigan Locha Filahor, a kindly Eddie Mitchell, as Renner Hamilton, a Tarik Le Politiot, in Ish, in me, Lunsa. Asura Bullshit Point, Antenib, Essen Glor, or Fat. Fat, you check a harder?
We'll throw on PJ Hernan.
Hand me down the tackle, and this is a bit of traditional music right from the heart of Connemara, where we were both, myself and John, born and bred and proud of it. Radio Shane Alanti Ian. Hope you all enjoying the chat tonight with Eddie Mitchell, independent candidate for Manor Hamilton. I'd like to, and me and Eddie now, or the two of us, would like to wish all the candidates for Leitrim the very best of luck in the upcoming election, Eddie, on June the 7th. As I'd say, there's always winners and there's always losers, but you know, pints and advice in the community is good to have to come in and speak to the local station where you can sit for a good while and gather your thoughts and speak openly. And that's the way it is, the People's Radio here at Radio South. Well, Eddie, what do you think of the community station being based in the heart of Leitrim here in Kinloch, between Bundoran and Kinloch, servicing the whole community and on the World Wide Web?
I mean, it's so important to have a place to discuss these issues. You know, to get even to, like, having to speak about them means that you have to think. You're thinking when you're speaking, when you're communicating, you're developing your ideas, you know.
Exactly.
Like, I have great belief in the people of Leitrim. I mean, Leitrim was able to beat the oil and gas industry. Like, so, you know, the people in Rossport, they fought for 15 years and eventually they were divided and beaten by the oil and gas industry. But they actually were the foundation for what we did, you know. And when we banned fracking in Leitrim, it was the foundation for campaigns all around the world. When, like, Ireland is a place where we can achieve stuff. So now we've proven that we're strong enough
to
beat
so.
These industries. Mm-hmm. So what I'm outlining to people this evening about this future Leitrim that's an extractive place, that's not the future for Leitrim. The future for Leitrim is the Leitrim people responding to the threat and defeating that threat. And what I'd say to all the young people, like, I was a building contractor and a farmer, I was a building contractor and a carpenter. And I came back to Leitrim thinking that I was going to have a quiet life and that maybe it might even be a bit bored, but I wanted to get home.
Yes.
My father was here and he wasn't well at the time and I wanted to come home. But no, I had no idea what was in front of me. Like, talk about a full life. I mean, you're struggling to solve these problems and working on these issues,
mm-hmm.
has become the very reason to exist now. Do you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Because it's so important that we defend. Like, what better way to live your life than to defend your place?
Exactly. Defend what's around you, your culture.
Yeah, yeah.
Your environment.
So, like,
your people.
We spent 6 weeks on the road in Belcoo. And we thought we were going to be arrested we thought we were going to be dragged away by police, but it didn't happen.
That's
because
true.
We were too strong. There was too many of us. So, so Leitrim people are capable of dealing. We are very resilient people.
And a majority, majority as well.
Yeah.
You know, and that's good too.
Yeah, and we. So if what I'd encourage is young people, like, think about it. What are you going to do when the corporates come to plant Leitrim? What are we going to do when the miners come to destroy the groundwater in Leitrim? Like, that's going to be good crack. We're going to be. What are we going to do when they come to do prospecting on farmers' land in Leitrim? Are we going to stand on the road when they go and they get their to go to the court and they get their injunction against the community to remove? Are the police going to remove us off the road? Are we going to win that back the same as we won it? I guarantee you we'll win it. We will win it.
Yes.
And when the people understand that how important keeping forestry out of the rest of Leitrim is, then it'll stop. But it's us not doing stuff. It's us not responding and understanding to these issues that allows it to go in silently without our knowledge. But we've passed that point. We know that we can stop stuff, and all we have to do is try and we have to stop thinking about other people having solutions.
Yes.
This, the power comes from the
people
standing on the ground saying no.
The same power.
Yeah.
When they worked for you.
Well,
to have their own voice in their own community, to stand up for them from a political level, in the right direction, speaking the truth and keeping your own side clean and clear for the generation that's coming up right after us. Because at the minute, they are very important.
Yeah.
If they're not involved, if they don't understand, how are they going to be dealing with it? In order to for them to understand it and to be dealing with it, they need you, Eddie,
yeah,
that speaks out and that's an activist against fracking in the past and everything,
yeah,
else, and fought for various issues in your community. That needs to be shared to them. So if,
yeah,
they actually do the same that you have done, because,
yeah,
there's no point for you doing it if it's not passed on.
Yeah.
So how do we get these people together to actually make their importance known to them, and that they actually understand, and that they're actually aware, and that they can stand on their own two feet, even at the age of 18 or 17, and say, well, now, this is wrong to our society here.
Mm-hmm.
We got to do something about this,
mm-hmm,
along with their seniors. And I think that's very important.
Yeah. Well, the easiest thing in the world is to write number one on the ballot to get me elected.
Yes.
That's, and there are other councillors that have, look at the candidates. Who's been involved in stopping fracking? Who's been involved in stopping gold mining? Who's been involved in stopping forestry? Don't vote for candidates that aren't involved in these battles, because if they're not involved in these battles, then they're not looking at the future of Leitrim.
Yes.
They're not involved in the struggles. These struggles are fundamental to the future. So like, if you'll have candidates talking about money, you know, I'm bringing money for this, I'm bringing money for that. If you're selling Leitrim, you'll get plenty of money.
Oh, you will, yeah, if you sell it, yeah.
If you're not talking about fracking and forestry and the future of Leitrim and being serious about
and
it.
And the agriculture as well.
The government, the extractive future, will send you money.
Well, they will, yeah.
They will. You'll get plenty of money.
Pay out to buy you out.
They'll pay money. They'll put money in front of candidates that will be silent on extractivism. And that's just the reality of a government objective to turn this place into a sacrifice zone. And they'll block people who are trying to protect Leitrim.
Exactly.
That's politics.
Or develop it further, you know.
Or develop
it. By saving it,
yeah,
you're developing it.
Yeah.
And then by the development,
yeah,
you have more population in it, because, you know, like, to start with any kind of environment situation or society,
yeah,
you've got to start with the foundation,
yeah,
first.
Absolutely.
And you have to protect that, because,
yeah,
if that's not protected, there'd be nowhere for people to come to.
Yeah. Like,
they'd be sold out already, you
see. These are environmental issues, but maybe that's the wrong label for them. We're talking about sovereignty, you know, we're talking about our right to self-determination.
Yes.
Like when we can't decide the future of Leitrim in Leitrim, that when other people are deciding it, that's an attack on our local sovereignty.
Of course it is, yeah.
And there's no them, there's just us.
Yeah.
Nobody has any power over us. We have to be able to stand together and decide that we decide the future for Leitrim.
Well, in solidarity, yeah.
So what I would say is, until Leitrim people can get planning permission for one-off rural housing, no corporate should be able to plant a tree.
Oh, not at all. No, they should not.
Like, why would we allow corporates to plant a tree when we can't get planning permission?
Why they don't need planning permission either, the forest.
Well, they
should.
They should need it. So if there is no process, like when we stopped, we didn't stop fracking without direct action. Direct action, I'm talking about peaceful direct action.
Mm.
That takes organised and it takes a huge amount of work. But so you could imagine that if I got into the council that I could solve all of these problems.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't. It's going to take campaigns. It's going to take people. So what I need is for people to not just vote for those people that are fighting, that are struggling in this area,
mm-hmm,
but to help us, join us.
Well, this is my call now on the whole lot to it, and I would be honest with you, Eddie. And to this day, I don't understand.
Yeah.
I don't understand. Like, it doesn't matter whether you're independent. Whether you're in Fianna Fáil, Fianna Gael,
yeah,
You are with peoplestar.org, or you are with Sinn Féin, or you with ELTHU, or any of those political policies or politics or organizations, as I call them.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, you're a human being.
Yeah.
Full of humanity for people, full of passion for people.
Yeah.
I don't know, if you go to the street and you meet one of your associates that's running with you at the minute, they will talk to you very, very well, and they will talk about you very, very well. In that case then, why he cannot all sit down as people and in the community that you're in, it doesn't matter what politics it is,
yeah.
and speak openly about the matters in question
yeah.
and back each other.
Yeah,
you know, and this is why I think it's very wrong, because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter who anybody's running for. Everybody should help each other, because if you help each other, you're helping your environment, you're helping your society, you're helping your youth, you're helping your education, you're helping your employment, and so on and so forth. So my policy says, in plain English, is come together,
yeah.
a circle, and the people that's trying to break the circle then, well, they don't belong to any political group, because really and truly, politics is one side of the matter, but situations in a community should be resolved by all members that's running
yeah.
and sit down together.
What
is wrong with them? I don't understand, because at the end of the day, we're human.
But you see, that's the way we can be successful.
Exactly.
But what happens in political parties is that parties are whipped. So in all of the main parties, there'll be a whip.
Oh, yeah.
And so if you're not following your party's policy, so we'd say, if you imagine Fine Gael or Fianna Fáil or the Green Party on mining, you know, like at the moment, Eamon Ryan is granting all these licences. If you were a councillor in the council and something comes up on mining, and you're supposed to support that, then you can vote. You can't really vote against that.
Well, we know that. But
yeah.
the
but,
community is but, actually voting for the councillors.
Yeah.
Because these, you know, it starts with the county councillors
yeah.
at community level.
Yeah.
It's like anything community. So if you're starting at a community level, my opinion is there should be some kind of togetherness
yeah.
and agreements. Because I'm quite sure that could be running under policies and
yeah.
political parties.
Yeah.
Do they agree? The answer is no.
Yeah.
I've spoken to many of them. They don't agree to it, but they're
people
they're
are telling me that they're not going to vote for the main parties. And I
that's
understand,
right.
I can
that too.
I'm not sure to what extent that'll come up in the government. But you've got pressure coming up from communities,
mm-hmm.
and you've got pressure coming down from the corporates. And
yes,
from,
exactly.
From the, you know, multilateral. Government,
yes.
you know, some of it is good pressure. Some of it is some of it serves interests that are very powerful interests.
Yes,
but we have to fight for our own space. Like.
Exactly,
and we are not going to become a sacrifice zone so that people in Palestine can be bombed. You know,
yes,
the solutions to those bigger problems are solutions like peace. In the world,
mm-hmm.
you know, not adding renewables onto fossil fuels just to have more energy and more demand and more consumers.
Mm-hmm.
Like we have to stand our ground locally, and win these battles. And what happens when we win them is other people see what we have achieved,
exactly,
and then they stand up as well. So it's important that, so what we're doing in Leitrim is important, because we've
Absolutely.
Already established the resilience that it takes to stand up to extractivism. But now...
And how many councillors running in Leitrim at the minute, Teddy, do you know?
So we have 12 candidates running for 6 seats.
How long? For 6 seats.
Yeah.
And they're obviously... Some of them are doubled up, like some independent people are running 2 seats, and Fianna Fáilers
yeah.
and probably the Shinners and Fine Gael and Into and all of these. And you know what, like, you know, people really, folks, need to read into what they're going to be working for and to gather your points together as well and to, you know, guide safely on what the councillors are saying when they're speaking to radio stations and media on the public airways, because really and truly what they're saying here to you is what they're going to do. And that's why, Eddie, can I ask you, why would you want the people to vote number one for you?
Well, vote for me because I was part of a movement that protected Leitrim. And the best evidence for doing something in the future is by looking at what people have done in the past.
Exactly. And results.
And results.
Now, solutions.
We're going to continue to fight. And the mandate, like I'm talking here about these issues because I want a mandate from people to deal with these issues.
Exactly.
So we will deal with all the issues, obviously, that have to be dealt with in the council. But we need to get a mandate to deal with these fundamental issues that decide the future of the country. Like we set up a sustainable farming group to look at the future of farming. We have to figure out what our future is. Nobody else can do that for us. And one person on their own can't achieve anything. It takes everybody. So we need people to engage.
Yes.
And to come and talk to us about issues, join our groups.
Talking about the groups, Eddie, I'm going to hand you this booklet and I'm going to ask you, tell people the groups that you're involved in.
Okay, so groups that we set up. Okay, so that was involved in the setting up of Love Leitrim, which banned fracking. It was one of 22 groups that banned fracking. I was a spokesperson of that group, and but there was a lot of people involved in that in that particular group. So that was successful in banning fracking. So the next group I mentioned here was the Leitrim Sustainable Agricultural Group. That's a group that was set up in partnership with the local authority.
Yes.
And what we were going to do was look at the future of farming. So we were looking at climate action, and we were looking at, you know, Leitrim and what could happen in Leitrim. And those of us that were involved fought to have land use. The biggest thing we have in Leitrim, the biggest resource we have, is all of this land.
Land.
So if we're going to, so that's we can. So it's really about like what we should be doing in Leitrim in
yes.
order to, you know, to create that autonomy that I was talking about, to create a future for farmers so that they'll be there to defend the land, you know?
Exactly.
So that's why that was important. So there's a North Leitrim Sustainable Energy Community that I'm involved in. So that's looking at renewable energy at the micro and local level, about community-owned renewables.
Yes.
And about that's an ongoing group. People could join that group. Treasure Leitrim is a group that that was put together to protect Leitrim from gold mining.
For gold mining, yeah.
Yeah, and for mining. There's Communities Against the Injustice of Mining as a network that was set up, an all Ireland network that was established to try and protect communities
mm-hmm.
everywhere, because 27% of Ireland now is covered in prospecting mining, and most people don't know. So that's a group that people can contact and we'll try and help them make submissions and trying to help them protect their own areas. So Operation Grounded is a network between the north and the south, and we've just recently achieved an agreement that there'll be a ban on petroleum licensing in the north. So that particular group has been operating since about 2017, after that we banned fracking in the south. So we've been working on fracking for 13 years. We banned it here, but it continued in the north, and it'll continue until it's finished
and closed, basically.
Yeah, so then there's groups then that I've sat on the Leitrim County Council Environmental Committee.
Very good.
Climate Action Group, so that's an SPC in the council. So that's just sitting on a committee making decisions. That's not an active, that's not like a campaign group. So I'm also a member of Save Leitrim. So we've
Lovely.
Been fighting against forestry since 2017. I work with Safety Before LNG. So one of the stories we didn't talk about here is one of the other major threats to Leitrim becoming an extractive area again is that when we banned fracking, the government then wanted to bring frack gas from America into the Shan Estuary.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we won the fracking, or the government conceded to the stopping fracking on the basis of climate action. But now they want to bring in this gas from America. So that the communities in America that helped us, they are now the people who will be extracted from in order to send gas to Europe. So more and more fracking for them. A lot of those people that we met early on in our campaign, they tell us now that their neighbours have passed on, a lot of cancer, a lot of stuff going on in those areas. All that water contamination and air contamination all led to serious consequences for those communities. But so what we've been doing is we've been trying to keep American frack gas out of Ireland, because if American frack gas gets into Ireland, we lose the argument on not extracting the gas from Leitrim.
Yeah.
Because the money's going out of the country to America, and the government are simply going to say, well, why are we not circulating that money in Ireland and having our own extraction? So we can't afford to let that gas in here. Now, it is government policy to keep frack gas out of Ireland, but in November, with all these wars that were going on, there was a U-turn on that policy. So that's not... So there was a signal of a U-turn. That U-turn hasn't been finalised yet. But we're going to find out very shortly if the Greens have decided finally to build a frack gas import terminal. So we're working on that. So also there, I was the vice chair of the IFA National Environmental and Rural Affairs Committee for 2 years.
Mm-hmm. Very good. That's a great point there.
Yeah. So that was I learned a lot on that committee. That's a national committee in the IFA. And I'm a member of IFA in Leitrim, and I was branch chair of the IFA.
Congratulations on that, Eddie. IFA is a great organisation to be involved in.
It has good grand democratic structures. If you go into the IFA, you can really work your way up into the organisation. It's very open. People don't stay in roles for very long. There's a continuous renewal.
Renewal of it, of course, yeah. Well, it's Eddie Mitchell with us this evening at the station here, Radio South. And he's asking for you to vote number one for him for the reasons that he has stated and the interview. Anybody who'd like to listen to the whole interview can actually listen to it on Facebook Live or on Facebook when we are off air as well, our jukebox here at Radio South. Follow our website as well, folks, and at Radio South. And as I did say, it's great actually to have the candidates coming in and speaking to the local station here and expressing what they would like to see happening in the local community for the people of the community. And I think that's very important. So that's why Eddie's looking for vote number one for Eddie Mitchell. If you all agree to saving your own environment, folks, and building it and making it bigger and better for the youth that's coming right up after us in the community. And again, as Eddie said, it'd be good to get them all involved because it belongs to them after our time. Tosh be geistach le radio shli an the lanthi an sha gin lach an acht a creel o brobehach in sha on studio. So we should find 10 miles of law. Tom with the creel o clar an ish. We're going to finish up the show here with Eddie Mitchell. The Weeks in Politics here at Radio South, and we'll be speaking to more of the politicians and the councillors as we go along. But it's great, Eddie, to have you tonight in the studio and sharing this with the community station.
Yeah,
I think it's amazing. And you know that this is going to be on the Facebook now and on all platforms and on our webpage as well, on our website. And that will be up in the next few days for you, and people can view the show. And as I did say, it's important, Eddie, isn't it, to stand your own ground and to basically make sure that you're making the right decision on the 7th of June for the community, for the people of the community. And Eddie, what would you say to finish off our conversation this evening?
Well, anyone that's I'm talking to Leitrim people. I want the young people in Leitrim to decide the future of Leitrim. I want you to come to understand these issues and take responsibility for the future. And I want to help, I want to be part of that.
Exactly, and it would be great for you to be part of that, as you're involved in major organisations there, and an activist in the fracking in 2017, and the Intuit that you brought to Tuan Indian Leitrim, and that is super amazing, and the fact that you have worked with the other side of the border as well, the northern side, and that they disagreed to the fracking as well, was a major, major success, Eddie, I must say. And I'm sure the farmers have a smile on their face, and I'm sure the farmers will come out to Leitrim and vote one for Eddie Mitchell, because they know well that he's going to save them a lot in the future, and for their children as well coming up right after them. As I did say, it's nice to see the farming industry going in clearly ahead in those areas, because this is important for the people. You would think the people first is very important, and as I do say, and I do say it on a lot of my shows, like, it'd be nice to home the Irish, not the world, as I do say. Well, it's the same with this, like, not to be letting people in, organisations in, and government organisations in, buying land and putting it to permanent use for forestry that never can be again corrected, because once it turns into a forestry, it's gone. It's gone from the people, it's gone from your fingers. There's no return, there's no turn back. Stop it before it's happened. Prevention before cure, folks. And that's what Eddie Mitchell is pointing out tonight, what he wants to do when he is elected for Leitrim. Isn't that right, Eddie?
Yeah, and it's, you know, we talk about trees, like, it's not been about against trees. It's about who owns the trees and how the trees, how they circulate money in the local economy.
Exactly.
Like, we want to see trees everywhere in Ireland.
Exactly, greenery.
The government wants to go from 11% to 18% forestry cover in Ireland. If everybody plants a few trees, there wouldn't be a problem with that.
Exactly. But what I would consider for those forestries and stuff, why not use the commonages and the bogs for it? Since we cannot use the bogs to cut the turf, well, why not give it to these
argument is made by the foresters. They love to plant the bogs, but you can't plant the bogs, because if we plant them, they release all the carbon.
But it's not even that. Like, there's commonage that's attached to the bogs. Commonage, which means common land that actually belongs to.
Yeah, but yeah. No, but I we're not plant the bogs. We won't be let plant the bogs now. That's changed. They're actually after the good land, the hilly land, the Dobby land. That we're farming on. There is no place, there's no silver bullet. If they want to plant trees, they have to come up with a solution that doesn't displace people.
Exactly, yeah. And that is used in commonage areas that's widely known out there. The whole county of Leitrim was full of commonage areas they can use for this, and they'll be very welcome to it. Oh, God, we've tended to...
I'm not agreeing with your argument.
But not the people's land,
But everybody can plant a few trees on their land.
On their own land.
And they're good for biodiversity and good for stuff. But we shouldn't get lost in the conversation about the trees. We need to think about the people and the displacement. If the people could survive with the trees, then the trees are welcome.
Exactly.
But the it's not about that. It's about corporates taking control over land.
That's what I mean.
But anyway, thanks, Marie, for having me on.
No problem at all. Mr. Francis, keep everything in mind, folks. And thanks very much for tuning in to Radio Set this evening. And it was a pleasure speaking to Eddie Mitchell this evening from Enor Hamilton. And I'm sure we'll be speaking to Eddie again in the future as well.
I'd love to come on and talk.
Yeah.
It's a great opportunity.
Expanded
people,
more.
People can listen to me.
Oh, indeed they can. I believe the show here is loaded. And thank you again to all the TikTokers as well, the youth. Oh, you're getting thumbs up there already from people on the Facebook feed. And thank you to the TikTokers as well, the youth who's tuned in from all over. And I hope it's a lesson that we've all learned, and indeed I have learned a lot too this evening that I didn't know about Leitrim, I must say, and I would definitely take that aboard. Now folks, we're going to go out with the last bit of music for this evening, and I hope you've all enjoyed the show. Ben with your Ash again, we're heading off to the Chasing Bull for the live show whenever we get there, and meet up with the band that's playing tonight and the customers and, of course, Mr. Doherty and his staff. So I hope you all now going to enjoy this last song. Tomorrow you catch us in the Shamrock Bar.
How long?
In the evening time. And back in the Rattling House in Leahy tomorrow night. Bella Vista on Sunday. And also back to Max Bar on Sunday evening. I hope you're all now going to enjoy the last song of tonight. And thanks for tuning in on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and TikTok. Say thank you to Eddie as well for coming in and speaking to us here at the local station, our community station, the people's station here, folks. And that's what we're here for. So everybody can express themselves and their voice can be heard. And that's important time at the minute for all the local politicians to come in and say hello and express themselves and tell us all who they are, what they're going to do for their own society and community. And I think that's important. But anyway, great pints tonight from Eddie Mitchell. So Eddie would like to ask you if you could vote number one for him to save your society. It's good night and God bless from Radio South. Eddie, thank you very, very much for coming in and speaking to me here at Radio South. And I am the founder of the local community station that started in 2019. So we're 5 years
ago. I enjoyed it. It was great. Oh, great chat. Great chat.
A great chat. Well, it was. And as I did say, we let the people speak. And that's what we do say. And we have plenty of time to speak myself when I'm on my show. So I don't need to be heard. I also only need to be seen at times. All right, folks.
Good luck.
Good night and God bless from Radio South. But we are going to be with Taoiseach again in the Chasing Bull in Bundoran. So follow us on there. Thanks to everybody on TikTok who's tuned in. Iwa, song before.